Good morning, everyone, on this beautiful spring day. That's probably one hour too early for many of us, and maybe for some that will be coming straggling in during the service, but that is all right. I thought we were going to do a gathering song here as people come in from the foyer as we get ready to worship together. And so we are going to sing number 49 out of our Purple Voices Together book, All Who Are Thirsty. And you can remain seated here, and we will sing through it twice.
All who are thirsty,
morning. My name is Laura Loewen. Before we continue with our time of worship, just draw your attention to one or two announcements. For those who are involved in the faith exploration class, please take note that there will not be a class this Sunday or next Sunday, and announcement will be made as to when it will commence. The other thing you will notice from the bulletin that and maybe see that our Pastor Rod is not with us this morning. He has not been able to manage his pain, and he anticipates surgery this coming Wednesday. So let's please keep him and his family in our thoughts and in our prayers in the days to come. The theme for this third Sunday of Lent is shaped by conversations. How have conversations changed you? Can you think of a time when, through a conversation, you received a new way of thinking about a particular issue, or a new way of seeing a person who you thought was so other, or when your ideas of God were expanded or changed? I can. This morning, we will witness the conversation between Jesus and the Samaritan woman, and how her worldview of God changed simply by paying attention and being open to what Jesus was saying to her. She was ready for that conversation. Join me in the call to worship as we prepare to be in conversation with the text through song and word. Come, let us bow down to worship.
Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker.
For the Lord is our God.
We are the people of God's pasture. We are the flock and God's care.
Let's continue in song by turning to our purple hymnal once again to number 28. Come, Christians, join to sing. Alleluia, amen. Please stand if you're able and join us for all three verses. Number 606, guide me, O thou great Jehovah. I don't play the piano that often, but all of a sudden I realized after I picked it and started practicing it, it was one that I did last month, but it's such a great hymn that why not do it again? So, yes.
Thank you.
Kids, come on up. Come on down. If you would like to sit on the bench, then you can look at us and also look up at the screen at the same time. Ready? So my name is Vanj, and this is
Helen.
And we had a conversation this week, and here are some things that Helen and I learned about each other, okay? Mostly about Helen. So, oh, welcome. Glad to see you too. Recently, a customer walked into the MCC thrift store in Clearbrook, looked at Helen sitting at the front desk, and asked, "What are you doing sitting there like that?" Gary, the store's assistant manager, looked at the customer and simply said, "She preaches all the time." Do you know what preaching is? To tell the truth about God, about Jesus, to preach a sermon. Usually, when we come to church, it happens right up there. We call that the pulpit. Well, so Helen told me that she had never, ever preached a sermon. So what did that store manager mean when he said, "She preaches all the time"? I think I found out. She's been preaching for a very long time. She's almost 100 years old. Helen used to live in India. She worked for MCC. She lived in the MCC building in Calcutta with her family. She was neighbors with Mother Teresa. She talked with her. They both liked to give food and clothing to people in their neighborhood. Many homeless people slept on the street and around the buildings close by. Helen told me that 70 families shared one water pump across the street from where she lived. Every week, an MCC driver took Helen outside of the city to a village. The villages had many refugees from Pakistan. Those days, over 7 million refugees had fled from Pakistan to India. One day, when Helen arrived at a new village, she was introduced as Indira Gandhi. The villagers all clapped for her. Someone introduced her that way because they thought that Helen Reimer looked like Indira Gandhi, the Prime Minister of India. So, why did Helen go to that village? She went because she wanted to teach them something that her mom had taught her. Not math. Not science, not reading or writing. She wanted to teach the women needlework. It would give them something meaningful to do. It would give them a way to earn some money. Do you know what needlework is? Come on up. Come and take a look. Helen will show you. I learned that Helen does needlework even now. Can you tell us about this?
I'm using thread to color the flower rather than something else, and it's material. So I've got the pattern here, and I use a needle and thread to color that, to embroider that. And it can be done in different ways. Something happens like this, but this is what I do even now, just using my needle and thread to finish the flower.
Can you see that? Pretty cool, eh? So this is what Helen went to the village to do, to teach some of the women how to do that. Okay, you can go back to the bench. I'll do it later. Sometimes young women from very poor families came to the MCC building where Helen lived. Helen taught some of them needlework too. The women learned to embroider some beautiful pictures on cloth with needle and thread. Helen, can you show us what some of those women in the village did? Would you like to come and hold one? You can hold one, and then you can just sit back there with it, and you can give it back later when you go back to your seats. Here's one for you to hold too. Yeah. Sorry, lost my spot. Napkins, so what you have, what you're holding in your hands right now, those are napkins that have been embroidered, right? But the women would also embroider tablecloths and wall hangings. Rachel, can you grab the wall hanging that I have over the bench there and show it to everyone? So this is a wall hanging of the whole world that's been embroidered. And by the way, it's for sale. If anybody wants to buy it, come and see me afterwards. Okay, thanks, Rachel. So, beautiful things like this were sold in stores called 10,000 villages in Canada and the USA to customers like your mothers, grandmothers, aunts, and maybe even some dads, grandpas, and uncles. The women who did the needlework were paid for the...
Don't leave me hanging just yet there, team. Okay, number 555. In our hymnals, Lord, I am fondly, earnestly longing. It's a gospel song that I haven't heard in a while, but I hope we can enjoy singing it together. So number 555, please stand again if you're able, and let us sing all three verses. Back to 536. I heard the voice of Jesus say, 536.
Thank you.
For the prayers of the people today, I invite the congregation to respond with "Hear our prayer" when you hear the words, "Lord, in your mercy." So, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Please join me in prayer. Creator God, we come to you with our prayers of thanksgiving this morning. Thank you for the beauty of the earth, for this land on which we stand, and the peoples who have cared for it over the centuries. We thank you for our homes, for our friends and families, for the community of faith gathered here in this building this morning. We are grateful for this country of Canada that has blessed us and been a country of peace and plenty. We are a privileged people, and we acknowledge that. We confess that we have so often taken our privileged lives for granted. Forgive us, and give us the courage, the humility, and a vision to make choices that are life-giving and that bring us into right relationship with you, with each other, and with the earth. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We bring to you the concerns of this community. We ask for your continued healing of Hans Tolles and Helen Dick. May they have the deep sense that they are surrounded by the care and presence of your spirit and this community. We come to you with our prayers for each other. We are not always aware of the various cares and concerns that are present in each other's lives. But you do. Whatever that care or concern may you hold it gently and give it your healing touch. Our thoughts and prayers are very much with our Pastor Rod and his family these days. As he approaches his surgery, may your peace be his, Kathy's, and their children's peace. May the surgeons and all who participate in the surgery be guided by their knowledge and given wisdom by your spirit. And as Rod waits for his impending surgery, we pray that his pain can be managed. May you anoint the Suderman family and us with the assurance that in the words of Julian of Norwich, all will be well, and all manner of all things will be well. For there is a force of love moving through the universe that holds us fast and will never let us go. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And now as we continue our time of worship, we come with open hearts and minds to hear what your spirit is saying to us today. May the words settle in our very being and guide our thinking, our words, and our actions in the days to come. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Amen. Our scripture text comes from John chapter 4, and I will be joined by James Dueckman and Barb Nickel. Sorry, Barb, I had a senior moment there. And there's also a part for the congregation at the end. So there's a part for the congregation on the left side. So on my left side, we'll do these two rows for the one that says left side congregation, and that side plus the balcony for the right side. John chapter 4, verses 5 to 42. So Jesus came to a town of Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, so Jesus, wearied as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well. The disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. It was about the sixth hour. A woman from Samaria came to draw water.
"Give me a drink."
"How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria? Jews have no dealings with Samaritans."
"If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water."
"Sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock.
Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water, welling up to eternal life.
Sir, give me this water so that I will not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water.
Go, call your husband and come here.
I have no husband.
You are right in saying, I have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one you now have is not your husband. What you have said is true.
Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship.
Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming, and is now here, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth.
I know that Messiah is coming. When he comes, he will tell us all things.
I who speak to you am he.
Just then, his disciples came back. They marveled that he was talking with a woman, but no one said, "What do you seek?" or "Why are you talking with her?" So the woman left her water jar and went away into town.
Come, see a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ?
So they left the town and went to Jesus. Many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony.
He told me all that I ever did.
When the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them, and Jesus stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman,
"It is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves.
This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. I'm Fran Hofenk, for those of you who don't know me. You might have been expecting to see a male pastor standing up front, and I'm sorry to disappoint you. Rod is, as you've heard, is not doing well, so I am blessed to be able to read his sermon. This is the one time I get to do a sermon where I didn't have to do all the preparation. So it is with pleasure that I'm reading this. And I just want to remind you that while I'm reading it, it is Rod's story. So when you hear the words, I, the word is referring to Rod while he reads that story. So I pray that God will bless you as you hear his words and those words that are so well written by Rod. Oop, wrong direction. What do you see when you see a homeless woman? A woman pushing a cart, walking down the sidewalk? Or the guy who cuts you off as you're driving down the street? Or maybe your grandchild as they are vying for your attention? As you make a meal or as you are doing another task? What do you think or see when you pass by an irritable neighbor? Did you see someone to pity, to tolerate, to ignore, to despise, or do you see the the face of Jesus. Encountering Jesus in our everyday lives, this is what I'm going to talk about today. I've learned a few things over the years by listening to people talk about their meetings with God. For one thing, many people have the erroneous notion that they must be on a retreat to encounter God, have a spiritual experience. They're busy searching for God. To encounter God means you are on a religious retreat, pondering scripture, paying attention to the sermon without dozing. These are ways to encounter God. While one can encounter God via these ways, most of the time people with whom I speak were not looking for God at all. They were minding their own business, doing this or that, and they were surprised to find that God gave them a role to play in God's business. I've heard it often enough to gain quite a respect for the resourcefulness of the Holy Spirit. Another thing I've learned is the location of these divine human meetings is rarely, and I can't tell you how this pains me to say this, it's rarely at church. On Sundays, people report that they have been inspired, or that was a good sermon, Pastor, or at least I was bothered by the service. But rarely do they report dramatic face-to-face, one-on-one meetings. I wish they did, considering how much effort we put into making Sunday morning worship meaningful and worshipful. Epiphanies sometimes happen on Sunday mornings, but often they don't. Now, people may encounter God while watching the sunrise from Sulphur Mountain in Banff National Park, while walking alone in the forest, or on a silent retreat in a Benedictine monastery. However, most encounters with Jesus take place at the mall, at work, through difficult relationships, in loneliness, in times of despair, or a chance encounter with someone at the park. God has, in my observation, the strangest sense of occasion, an odd idea of location. But who am I to tell Jesus where and when how often he ought to intrude into someone's life? Our faith would be so much easier if we could schedule a visit with Jesus so that we could have a casual, open-ended conversation. Would our spiritual life be so much easier if the Holy Spirit's work would be confined to 10:30 to 11:45 during Sunday morning worship, especially when the preacher is speaking? Alas, as Jesus told Nicodemus last Sunday, the wind, pneuma, blows where it will. Whether or not you're ready for it, looking for it, or even want it. This is all on my mind because we have met this woman, a Samaritan woman. She has baggage. For one thing, she is a she. And we have a pretty good idea of the role of women in the church history. Years ago, one of my classmates from CMBC was ordained as a pastor. Someone made a joyous statement following the ordination service. "Carol, isn't that great that the Mennonite church is ordaining women?" To which Carol replied, "Yes, and it only took the church 2,000 years to do it." Back in Jesus' day, rabbis, teachers of the law, didn't waste words of wisdom attempting to teach theology to women. Back in the Bible days, women were property of men, so it was impossible for men to believe that the Spirit of God, the wind of God, would blow upon a woman. But here is this Samaritan woman who is on an ordinary weekday on her way to draw water for her family, has this conversation with Jesus, and becomes one of the characters in some of Jesus' most complex teachings. She has a second problem. She is a Samaritan. Jews were, we are told by John, had no dealings with Samaritans. Why? From the Jewish perspective, there were a number of reasons why this was so. The first, Samaritans were racially impure. They were, for those of you who Harry Potter series, they were the muggles of the world. Samaritans refused to worship in the city of God, Jerusalem, because their scriptures, that were the most, for the most part, the same as the Jewish ones, instructed them to worship on Mount Gerizim. And finally, Samaritans were actually enemies of the Jewish people. As her conversation with Jesus moves along, we also find that she has been through several marriages, which have ended in either divorce or death. Either way, she's had a tough and difficult life. And you know how the church has intended to treat victims of great misfortune. Churches avoid them. She can't believe this man, a Jew, talks to her, a Samaritan, wrong gender, wrong race, and wrong religion, an enemy, messed up morals, or just bad luck. Yet Jesus initiates conversations with her, reaches towards her, and engages her. And at a well, she didn't go there for a Bible study. She wasn't there searching for something deeper in life. She was there for the most ordinary of everyday tasks that most of the world's women still must do at the beginning of every day, go to a well and draw water. Jesus says something to her about water. She replies with, "Where are you going to get water with no bucket?" Jesus says he's offering her living water despite any of her failures or sadness. And she runs all the way back home to tell people, "Come and see a man who told me everything I have ever done. He cannot be the Messiah, can he?" Then those Samaritans who were there also went on to see Jesus on their way to see the person who had come to them. Isn't this amazing? She, a Samaritan, a woman, spouseless, becomes one of the first preachers of the gospel. She was the first to run and tell everyone about Jesus. All she meant to do that day was to get water for her family. True, Jesus doesn't give her much detailed instruction in faith. She doesn't seem to even understand much of his puzzling talk of living water and worship in spirit and in truth. But what Jesus does is as important as what he says. Jesus encounters her, converses with her, takes her seriously, intrudes on her where she is, calls her just by his few words to preach. She doesn't run away shouting the Apostles' Creed, "I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son." No, there were still too much newness, too many mysteries. She was left with a question. He can't be the Messiah, can he? A hint, a door opened, a light flickering in the dark. It's not everything that God said and did. It's not the whole of historic faith, but it's a start. It's a question, the question on which all else depends. And it's God's initiative, God's spirit moving, God's gift to someone who didn't even ask for it, someone who has the wrong person, who was the wrong person at the wrong time and at the wrong place. "Love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you," Jesus said, giving us a gospel, challenge that flies in the face of our human instinct for self-protection and society's admonition to look out for number one. How can we learn to see Christ not only in the innocent face of a newborn child, or in the eyes of a beloved spouse, or in the touch of a grandchild, but also in the people who make our lives in one way or another difficult? It's challenging to see Jesus in an enemy, someone who is ridiculing us or who has harmed us in some way. Where could Jesus be in that person? Donna Maria Cooper O'Boyle, in her book, Rooted in Love, has this quote: "I believe the only possible way we can discover Jesus in our enemies is through God's grace and an effort on our part to act upon that grace and further to commit ourselves to finding Jesus in everyone. This can only happen through prayer." Through prayer, yes, but I would like to add also through practice. The Samaritan woman was on her way to draw water and encountered a Jewish man, an enemy of the Samaritans. Yet she was open enough, brave enough, curious enough to engage this stranger and through it venture the question, "He cannot be the Messiah, can he?" I bet we all have plenty of opportunities in the course of a typical day to see Jesus in the eyes of a spouse, a child, a friend who might be causing us unhappiness or discomfort, even if they are not an enemy. During those difficult moments when we respond with openness and love, we open ourselves up to the possibility of being transformed. Keep in mind that we are all works in progress, and so we don't always live up to the gospel ideal. Still, with regular prayer and practice, we move closer. We must trust God to present the opportunities for conversations in our lives, the people, the situations, and we must pray that we will respond to God's Spirit moving to everyone with love. It doesn't just happen. We have to pray and be open to encountering Jesus in our daily routines at our own wells. Thank God that the Samaritan woman didn't respond with, "I'm sorry, I've got water to draw and work to do. I'm busy. My religious meter isn't on just now. See you on the Sabbath if you want to talk religion." I'm glad she had the courage. Yes, I call it courage, not to run away, but to listen and to marvel, to relish the moment, to consider the possibility that she didn't know everything and hadn't seen everything yet. Her thirst for God, her thirst to experience God, her thirst to see God meant she was open to encountering God, even at a well in the heat of the day. She dared to relish the moment. She dared to engage by this mysterious stranger, risked letting the conversation with Jesus move her from encounter to a life-changing question. She was moved from her conversation with Christ to a first step, a courageous willingness to be shocked, surprised, intruded upon. She wasn't only a woman willing to be addressed by a strange man, but also a Samaritan willing to consider the possibility of a Messiah she didn't know. Who is a Christian? A Christian, at least on this Sunday with the Samaritan woman, is someone thirsty enough to be open to the possibility that something's afoot and the Spirit of Christ isn't the only mysterious, but also it's also revealing that even though you may not have the time or the inclination to look for God, God in Jesus Christ just might be looking for you. Tomorrow, when you take your bucket or a keyboard or a book, keep looking over your shoulder, not in fear or paranoia, but look over your shoulder in anticipation. Something's afoot. Be open and ready to have conversation with others, and maybe even a conversation with Jesus. Be thirsty enough, friends, to have conviction that God is active, personal, and above all, present to us. We don't have to withdraw from the world into a quiet place to find God. God's footprints can be found everywhere, in our work and in our relationships, in our families and our friends, in our sorrows, in our joys, in the sublime beauty of nature, and in the mundane details of daily lives. Be thirsty enough to see and encounter God in everything you do and in everyone you meet. Maybe even begin your day with prayer. God, grant me the insight this day to see you in the eyes of another person. Be willing to venture the question. He cannot be the Messiah, can he?
Thanks, Fran. As a song of response, as well as sending and blessing, let us sing our theme song for Lent, number 848, Christ Be All Around Me. And please stand for the song and then remain standing for the benediction.
Our benediction this morning is based on 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 7 to 9. May the seed of Christ's word, planted and watered by the Holy Spirit, find root and grow in your hearts. May your work and your relationships with Christ reflect Christ's constant presence in the days of this week. Amen. Go with God's peace.